we went into News of the World, you know, we couldn't reinvent ourselves as a punk band. But we wanted it a little bit more simple. We thought maybe these really grandiose things weren't really quite what was happening then. And to be more of the time, I guess, we made a more straightforward record.
People said, oh, you know, you're doing that because of punk. But actually, it wasn't really. It was just that we'd gone as far as we possibly could into the sort of baroque, complex, incredibly elaborate arrangement stuff. And we thought, well, it would be fun to go back to the way we used to play when we first started, which would be quite simple, guitar, bass and drums.
I really like News of the World. It's one of my favourites, I think. Right down the line. And, of course, it had two monster singles on it. We Will Rock You, We Are the Champions. We always thought of them as a pair.
We Will Rock You and We Are the Champions had a very sort of definite genesis. We played this great hall in the Midlands and it was packed. It was heaving. You know, those gigs that you love, it's all sweaty and hot, the atmosphere's great, everybody's in it, everybody's jumping up and down, making a noise. And what they were doing was singing along. They didn't stop. They sang every note of every song. And when we went off stage, they sang You'll Never Walk Alone to us. Now, in those days, it was really new, I have to tell you. You just didn't go to concerts where people sang to rock bands. So we went home that night thinking, what do we do here? What does this mean? What does this mean for our future? Obviously, the audience is as big a part of the show as we are now, so let's embrace it. What can an audience do? What could you ask them to do? They're all crammed in there. They can't do much, you know, but they can stamp their feet, they can clap their hands, and they can sing. And they would be leading the song rather than the singer. So I woke up with We Will Rock You in my head. I sang the song to Freddie, and he went, yeah, it's gonna work. He twigged that it was a kind of rallying song. Buddy, you're a boy, make a big noise, playing in the street, gonna be a big man someday. You got mud on your face, you big disgrace, kicking your can all over the place, singing We Will. In my head, it was a song of three ages of man. The first age is the boy who thinks he can change the world. The second stage is the man who thinks he is changing the world. Buddy, you're a young man, hard man, shouting in the street, you're gonna take on the world someday. You got blood on your face, a big disgrace, waving your banner all over the place. And the third stage is the old man coming to terms with the fact that there's only a certain amount he can do. It's a bit like the serenity prayer, you know, change what you can change, but get used to it that you can't achieve everything. Buddy, you're an old man, poor man, pleading with your eyes, gonna make you zombie someday. You got mud on your face, big disgrace, somebody better put your bag into your place. So I came up with We Will Rock You and Freddie came up with We Are the Champions, and I think his thought process was very similar.
We've decided that on our albums, we wouldn't spend as much time as we've done in the past, because I just think that, especially with News of the World, I think we actually did decide before we went in that it was going to be a short album as far as Queen stands concerned. I mean, so that was like 2 months instead of four. We had something like a week and a half to 2 weeks to actually write all the material in. And that was nice, so that we didn't fall into this thing of it being overripe before we actually recorded it.
It's weird.
I don't know, we spent 5 or 6 months in the studio and very long hours, so just physically you couldn't be in the studio all the time. The News of the World is back to a more spontaneous kind of creation of an album. Because of the nature of the way that we did it, we were all in the studio at the same time for a lot of the time. And it was more of a group thing than perhaps A Day at the Races was.
It was easy because it was so simple. After what we'd been doing the stuff on News of the World, it was almost de rigueur to do it quick, because you didn't want to mess around with it too much. You didn't want to polish it too much. You wanted to keep the rawness there.
especially a group in our stage of career, can fall into the trap where we can have as much time as we want in the studio. And you can just go and say, look, I'd like to try another area of this. But now I think it was up to us to decide from the very onset that this is the decision, you know, this is what we're going to arrive at before we got there. And we were going to say, OK, this is it. And I feel like I did that. I mean, OK, I could forever go around saying that I could have done, say, We're the Champions a bit better. But I think I quite liked actually saying, look, I've made my sort of decision now, and we're going to stick to it. And it's worked out pretty well.
Is this on?
Test, test.
Knock, knock.
Hello?
How does the studio situation work, Freddie?
You mean amongst us?
Yes.
Between us?
Yeah.
If I write a song, then I sort of take it upon myself from the actual writing stages to the rehearsing, to the routining, and to the recording as being my project, so I sort of handle that. Mm. With my kind of songs, I seem to sort of more or less have everything rehearsed. I mean, everything's sort of written out.
I've taken my bows and my curtain calls. Well, you brought me fame and fortune and everything that goes with it.
I want on a pan
what, the echo, yeah.
Well,
yeah, it will be.
He had a vision and he was very driven, and he was very good on the desk, you know, and very good moving the faders, balancing the harmonies and getting the things to do what he wanted. But then we'd pitch in with each other's songs, and then sometimes we'd all get together to mix it.
When did you begin to get to a stage where you felt between you that you could take over the desk yourselves completely?
It comes to a stage where all you really need is an engineer, really, because the idea of balancing and sounds you want. I mean, an artist or musician should really know what they want, you know, and the only person needed to implement that is an engineer, really, in a way. And when you're doing a mix, you know, when you're mixing down the track from the tapes, I mean, you know, it's setting it up, and then we actually sit down and work the controls as well, you know. Yeah.
Can you remember which vocals, which solos were used?
Well, if you hear them, I'll know.
Because here we've got four tracks of vocals, one with a solo guitar, and then that's got N-bit solo.
Well, listen to them, darling, that's the only way we can do it.
That's your writing, isn't it, that one?
No, it's all mics. What are you doing now?
I'm just going to get a rough balance, so I think.
There's two guitars. One crosses over.
Right.
Do you remember?
Yes, I remember.
That one is. Go back to the other place and then find out.
Just the last chorus.
Do you want to do a guitar or something? You know,
I suppose we
could.
It would sound different.
Do you want to do a guitar bit in there? Squeeze it in. To work out your guitars, then you can mix.
Where are they?
Roger, do you want to come in here and just do
the kit?
Yeah.
Um back to cinemas. What do you think for sounds? I mean, I think we should just...
Yeah, it sounds all right to me.
Yes, he's only done drum sounds at the moment.
Sounds right,
doesn't it? Oh, well, that's right. Sounds all right to me.
What was a roadie?
Oh, let's open a bottle of wine.
Yes, well, where is the screwdriver?
Congratulations, you're number one on the hit line at the moment. How's that for loyalty?
I think it's great. I quite enjoy all this battle, you know, between ABBA and whoever, you know, X, no, whatever, you know. It's very enjoyable, you know. It's always when I sort of, I must admit, I did quite often tune in. And it's nice to hear if it's not wrong. It's a very good instant reaction to what you've sort of put out.
And only Queen could come up with the title We Are the Champions. I mean, where's the modesty gone?
Well, there isn't any. There's no modesty whatsoever. After the slaggings off what we get from the English music press, I mean, who cares? I mean, we've got nothing to lose now.
Because pulling We Are the Champions off the new album, that seems to me to have thoughts and sentiments in it that you must have been wanting to express for some time. Mm. Is that true?
Oh, I'm a cold, heartless bugger. No, it has absolutely nothing. It's just pure commercial. Call it what you like.
Can you go easy on the stage lights? Because they're so fucking hot. Oh, that's a bit better for now.
It's the most egotistical and arrogant song I've ever written.
Yes,
was it so?
I was kind of quite shocked because I thought, are we really going to stand up and say, we are the champions, as opposed to every other group and every other person on the face of this earth, you know? And he said, actually, that's not what it is. And he said, rock and roll is the only place where everybody has a feeling of like being in a team, but you're not fighting anybody.
Basically, it is a participation thing. I've been very cold-blooded, and I'm just thinking in terms of how we're going to sort of adapt it on stage, and then how people are going to. It's a public stroke group thing, really.
We're going to be finishing off filming for We Are the Champions, which, of course, you know, is the new single from the band. Yeah, I don't know whether you've heard it. First of all, have you heard it on the radio? I understand it's number two on the hit line on Capital Radio tonight, so for you. We'd like your involvement, if you would, towards the end, because if you've got any banners that you can wave towards the end, hundreds, get those out and shout and scream and sing with the band.
Because it's far more kind of raw than any other album, and also shorter tracks.
I'm glad you said raw, because that was exactly really what we wanted.
Okay, you're ready to rock and roll!
You get involved in quite a lot of music outside of the band and outside of the band's style, don't you? I mean, I remember you talking really in the very early days, for example, about Sex Pistols. If you hear something that's or hear of something that's exciting, yeah, but there seems to be so few.
Roger
Roger
was much more aware than the rest of us. He sort of kept in touch with what was going on. And I remember him talking about the Sex Pistols very early on and getting excited about it.
I thought, you know, this is so fresh. And I thought we needed a little bit of that kind of sensibility.
Sheer Heart Attack, which is a song of Roger's, which had been trying to get on an album. So we thought, oh, it makes sense in this context, only something simple and energetic. So in a sense, we went a little bit sort of punky ourselves.
It was sort of written a few years before, and I thought, oh, this fits perfectly. This really fits in with what we're trying to do now, so we put it on that album. And it became a live staple. Murder to play on stage is so fast.
We were making this album in North London, and in another studio just nearby was this young group called the Sex Pistols.
We were literally next door for months. Sid Vicious came in, and Sid was a moron, you know, he was an idiot. Fred played him a few things and played him Sheer Heart Attack, actually. I think he said, it sounds like the Cortinas. And there was the moment when Sid said, are you bringing ballet to the masses? Then Fred his own, oh, Mr. Ferocious, we're trying our best here.
How are the rehearsals going, Brian?
Very well up to now, up to their usual standard, I think, which is usually slow up to the last minute and then panic. But it's going OK.
How much time have you put aside this time?
We have a full week here in Shepperton, where we are now, which is without the PA, but we have the monitors, so our stage environment is more or less as it will be. And we have a mock-up of how the lights will be. And then the stuff is dismantled and goes to the States, and we follow it out a week later, and then we have 3 or 4 days with everything, and with John working the PA and everything.
Mm. How much of News of the World are you going to do this time?
News of the World will feature heavily, partly because it's easy to do. Most of the stuff is fairly simple in terms of instrumentation. And it was built around stuff which is easy to do on stage, which really is the first time we've done that since the first album. So there'll be a lot of it. We've already been through 5 or 6 numbers off the new album.
It must be interesting finding that exact balance between new material and old material too, Brian.
Definitely, yes. Because a lot of people come to see a show for the familiar things. And always at the end of any artist's show, generally, when he starts doing the old stuff, people respond in a completely different way. So you have to, as you say, you have to strike the balance between doing the things which people want to hear and doing the things which you think you ought to be introducing them to.
I think it's asking too much.
They've come to see it. They're not going to see it. They want to see what we're going to do. This is a new show. This is something, what we're going to perform.
I think it worked great as an author, you know.
I think we should do it. You know, the whole thing of We Will Rock You is stating that...
Yeah.
There's no point in saying we will rock you after we've rocked them all along at the end of the show.
Yeah.
We love designing these sort of dramatic openings, and particularly the beginning and the end of a show is a great opportunity to do something special. And We Will Rock You, I think in my head, was partly conceived as an opener anyway. I thought, wouldn't that be great just to start off with this very stark stamping and clapping, and it'll be like the audience is starting the show. Freddie would go out and do his thing, all on his own, you know, hero.
We will rock you.
go out on the other side, do the guitar solo, Hero. Then it's like, what do we play now? You know, when we get to the end of the guitar solo, what happens? There's this huge kind of anticipation at the beginning of a show. You've got to be high energy. You've got to fulfill that kind of expectation. And on the record, you go into We Are the Champions, but that wouldn't be right, because We Are the Champions really cries out to be the end of a show. So we thought, what do we do here? And it, for some reason, I thought, well, a fast version of We Will Rock You would be really interesting. Very effective. It was just all very simple, very high energy, and the audience could kind of bang their heads and get into it and feel that their energy was being harnessed. America's great. You feel like America is the center of rock music somehow. There's a real family which surrounds music in America. You go there and you feel that you're part of it. You know?
You say you love me. America was regarded as the sort of grail of the rock scene in those days. And obviously when you sort of smell success in America, you go for it.
America was so geared up for rock and roll, much more so than any place else at that time. It had an amazing, thriving community, which we plugged into. And in a sense, we created our audience, but in a sense, they created us, a very formative influence on us. And it was a riot. It was amazing. The energy that would be in those American halls was outstanding. I think we grew up on those American tours as a band. And you start to think of yourself as artists, in a sense. It's love, when I'm bleeding deep inside.
sure that the whole, all the lights, all these gaps are filled
up. Oh, yeah.
You must aim for maximum effect, both orally and visually. We're just trying to put over the music and the visual aspect as effectively as we can to as many people as we can.
We think it should be a real event every time we play.
People are paying money to come and see you. So
yes,
I mean,
as far as we're concerned, we're putting on a show. It's not just another rendition of an album. If that was the case, we might as well just have sort of cardboard cutouts and just play the album.
Stay pretty connected. Generally, we sort of found a big place where we'd all get ready together and we would kind of joke around and talk about stuff. So we had a good kind of camaraderie, which kept us alive.
Arnold!
Sorry.
Oh, my God, get a shirt on.
Oh, shit, I threw my whistle away, actually. I bet you can't blow him like that. I hesitated, actually, I did. I thought I threw it at him. I should ask for it back. I want it back.
You threw my best fucking pair of maracas away the first day. Great sound maracas. I mean, it took me hours to steal them.
Now they know I'm going to throw those
just
things.
Goes...
Actually, they were wonderful, I must say. I'm sorry. But they, now they know I'm going to throw them in the audience. They give me these horrible things with about 2 peas inside, you know, and they just rattle, rattle, rattle. I thought, I feel such a bug going. Nothing happening, so I just throw it away.
Lovely colours as well.
Yeah, lovely colours, lovely kitsch colours. Real height of bad taste.
Really?
He's throwing me in the audience.
Don't give him ideas.
You don't rattle as good.
Are you happy with the response on the tour so far?
Well, very much so, I think.
Yeah.
Yes,
yeah.
Yes.
See, I think it's worth pointing out, really, that it's the most successful tour on the road right now, isn't it?
If you say so, it is.
Yes.
Well, we wouldn't want to keep abreast of it, but yes. Yes,
yes, it is, really.
There's a lot of competition around. I mean, there is... how many groups on the road? I mean, it's...
Well, I don't know. Of the sort of halls we're playing, no more than half a dozen.
The people here are just geared to going to actually seeing so many rock concerts that, I mean, it's like a way of life, really, isn't it? Mm.
Particularly what strikes me on this tour is how well put together the stage is, how well designed it is, and how well the stage show works. Can you describe the opening and how you got the idea for it, Freddie?
How did I
what
get
do you
the
mean
idea
how
for
you
it?
Got the idea for it?
I don't know. Usually our ideas kind of... how did it start? Somebody comes up with an idea and it's immediately rejected. Mm-hmm. But it kind of sort of seeps in after a while, once it's kind of
they
thrown
want to
about.
They get a row on film, you see.
Yeah, oh, they want to get a row. You should have been there yesterday. Well, you were there yesterday, but the cameras weren't really.
I'm playing what I always play. I'm playing exactly what is on the record, Fred.
You do slow down.
Oh, fuck, slow down. That's hardly the point.
Hey, just give us a bit more feel. We might try and really join in with you. Well, you're expecting all of us to be perfect before you even
say,
attempt to do anything.
Oh, don't be so fucking ridiculous.
Don't take it down.
That's all right.
That's all right.
I hear we split up last week.
Yeah.
According to the enemy or something.
Yes, we actually we must develop that. Just to a point. Mm. How did that develop, those rumours?
Oh, it's. Mm. It's not. It's so. It's a lot of trivia. It's not even worth talking about.
Was there any basis in fact for that speculation at all?
Not as far as I know.
Breaking up when we're doing so well. God, yeah. You must be kidding.
I think the most important thing is for a band. Basically, it has to be good, and it also has to stick together. I think. And know each other backwards, you know. You've got to almost know what the other person's thinking. I mean, a band has to stick together until there's no longer any point in it sticking together, if you see what I mean? But mind you, when it is all over and there's not really much coming out of it anymore, you've got to quit then, I think. I'm sure we will when that happens.
Should we do something out front? See if the fucking monitors work here.
We did, in a sense, become a little less cohesive, I suppose. But I think the great thing for us was that we always did sound checks. We did long sound checks every day, and so much happened in the sound checks. We would talk to each other, look at each other, discuss things. We'd figure out what was good about last night, what wasn't good about last night, and, you know, let's try this, let's see if we can get this song together and try out things and have a bit of fun. It's a kind of dedication, really, but boy, it pays off. So I think that saved us from getting fragmented and disconnected. Get your body down, get your pigtail down, get your heartbeat, baby. Get your timing right, get your act all tight. It's gotta be tonight, my little screwy. Mama says you don't, daddy says you won't, and I'm boiling up inside. No way I'm gonna lose out this time.
Touch more vocal. One, two.
One, two, one, two.
Sammy was low, just watching the show over and over again. One, two, one, two.
Sammy was low, just watching the show over.
London, you're going to be presumably looking at your whole business situation and reviewing it.
Yes, I think we're going to, let's face it, we're going to sort of try and sort out a lot of business. So-called business problems. And I think, you see, we've always wanted, the Queen, the so-called Queen empires, I mean, it's pretty large now. We've all got sort of subsidiary companies and things. And it needs a lot of handling.
Nothing can be.
Are you in the process of restructuring at the moment, business-wise, John?
Potentially, yes. I mean, we didn't get a penny of record royalties from the first three albums from them. It was so basically, we got out of that one, right, by re-signing with a guy called John Reed. We signed with him for 3 years, right, which finishes in about September next year. And what we're looking at that point in time is basically to just look after ourselves and, yeah, you know, and do it completely on our own.
It's the long road to artistic and financial freedom, you know, which is so hard to find if you're successful to any degree, because there's a million sharks out there. So hard is spread your wings and fly away. Fly away. Far away. Spread your little wings and fly away.
another one. Yeah.
Ow, ow, ow.
Handsome, isn't it? I lost my shoe.
I like to think that I can do different things. I mean, I don't like to sort of just think, okay, rock and roll, so therefore I'm going to go up there, put on my high heel shoes and play the songs. I like to think that we do so many different types of songs that then when we try and put them over, they require a different sort of format. And within that is it's a wide area.
Why don't you do a nice picture of Rodgers and Hicks?
Taylor dies.
Away! Who could I don't do my own? Dane! Do.
I feel a lot of people now realise when they come to see Usher that they're going to get a lot of contrast.
We're not scared of trying out different ideas, you know. I think one of the things that we really steer clear of is trying to sort of repeat the same formula. That's not the thing done in rock and roll. I mean, can you imagine it?
As the albums have progressed, I mean, our sort of songwriting has progressed and we sort of ventured into sort of different areas. When people hear them on the records, we like to do them on stage. I mean, like, doing Melancholy Blues, one particular song, it's so different from anything that we've done before. It's nice. I mean, you know, it's nice. It's very sort of difficult at the same time. But it's something that we're not used to.
Another party's over and I'm left cold sober. My baby left me for somebody new. I don't want to talk about it. Want to forget about it. Want to be intoxicated with that special brew. So cut me. Let me I'm in for a cloudy and overcast. Don't try and stop me, 'cause I'm heading for that stormy weather soon. I'm causing a mass sensation with this new occupation. I'm permanently glued to this extraordinary mood.
We're halfway through the tour with Queen now, and it's proving to be, relative to everything else that's on the road this autumn, a very, very successful tour. We've just come back from a gig at the Atlanta Stadium. and we're just going up. I've already got one to the bar to get another drink.
On the table and kick it.
What a control!
On the table and kick it.
What? Oh fuck! The Midwest could get on your nerves because of the sheer repetition of it, and every town looks so much like the other. And you did feel like you were in a culture vacuum sometimes.
Sorry.
All we have is bad televisions, vibrating beds, even worse, and bad food. But it was still a lot of fun. There was loads of sex and drugs. And, no, there wasn't. There really wasn't much sex and, well, there wasn't much drugs.
Horrible use of the space player. He's going to start taking.
I've got a photograph of him.
Smiling? Oh, how did he get that?
He even managed to get on the video.
I fucking tripped tonight. I was so pissed at myself. I came hardly got it now I'm here in the darkness. Went arse over tit. Did you see that? That's why I came sort of. I kind of slipped and I went hurtling on and did all this. It really puts you off, though. It felt real.
I seem to get together tonight. I mean, I enjoyed it.
Together. Brian broke a string in a
well, the most awkward spot. I mean, like, in the middle of Liar, where there's a crescendo and it comes to a low, and then he has the cue, so we're all waiting, and he broke the string. So he's changing, we're all, I'm standing in the spotlight. But anyway, oh, we've been in worse things. They were good, yeah. It's been different this time, I don't know. Last time they were, the places were smaller, a bit smaller, but they were more up. This time, I suppose, they brought their mums and dads.
You've achieved so much now over the last 5 or 6 years, and I was wondering now what targets you have left to achieve, really.
Number one album in America would be nice.
Yeah, we've never had a number one over here. We've had very successful sort of 2 million selling albums, but we haven't had a number one album. I don't know, and also we could be a bigger draw than we are, you know.
Yes, I mean, we haven't. I don't think the wrong thing to do is to actually sort of see ourselves with a particular goal to meet, you know? I mean, to say, this is where I want to go. It's got to be so wide that, I mean, you just keep going. I mean, there's this sort of areas are endless, really.
Mm. You're going to take some time off when you go back to London, aren't you?
That's the plan, yeah. You have to get refreshed every now and again, and we haven't really had a holiday for the last 4 years or so. We've always said this is time off, but then it isn't, because you get involved in projects. So certainly for me, I'm going to get as far away as I can.
True, I think we really deserve it. Yeah, I think, oh, we bloody well do. I think we've been kind of sort of putting it off for the last 6 years, really. And I think the time has come where we can kind of ease off a bit. And just, I mean, on this tour, I've been surviving on just jabs. And I mean, I don't mean that in that sense. Oh, please, mother. No. But the show goes on.
My dues, time after time, out of my sentence, but committed no crime and bad mistakes. We'll be right back.
Yeah.